Mr. Batni, Mr. Dinesh, Subbu, friends, I am grateful to all of you for the opportunity to share some thoughts, very popular kind of thoughts, if I may. Not very deep scientific things, but actually something which is common to all science or the way we do science. So I like to look more at the mechanics of doing science of any kind, whether it's engineering, technology, or what have you. Not really domain-specific way of doing things, but thinking more about the scientific common sense, you know, which is, of course, not very common, at least in our educational system. Right? There is no recipe to how well you can, you know, use common sense. There is no recipe, so it's that much harder to teach it. What I like to do is give you some examples of doing lateral thinking and how that helped us solve many difficult problems of science or technology. So thanks very much again for the opportunity. I see many old friends and hope to make some new ones. I'm very proud of association with Infosys. Almost feel like a part of extended family of Infosys, a great company. So there are four things that I want to talk about. A very brief introduction to what nanotechnology is. Of course, nanotechnology, you could do 5 courses in it and not really know very much about it. So I'm going to do it in 4 slides. So it's a nano introduction to nanotechnology. The second part of the talk is, well, what can we learn from nature? Right? There are a huge number of amazing technologies waiting out there in the nature. And if we could observe those and translate in our practice, well, that would be something really great. I mean, nature is far ahead of us, you know, in terms of technology, because just been working at it for millions of years. We just haven't had that much time to do it. It's also very interesting that, you know, we have known quantum mechanics and general theory of relativity and stuff like that for a very long time. But we didn't know what makes lotus leaf water repellent. Right now, I mean, that's a great technology if I could make paints that are water repellent or surfaces, like a lotus leaf, right? But the problem with scientists, the way we do science, if we like to sit in the lab, we look at the computer more often than we look at lotus leaf, right? But if we can observe nature in all its glory, there are, well, really great lessons there to be learned and be translated in technology. So I'm give you some examples about, well, what can we do with nature, how can we work with it to make better technologies, but also to understand a lot of fundamental issues in science. The third part of the talk is, well, what about this scientific common sense and creativity, which is kind of lateral thinking, and it's very hard to tell what it really is. So I like to give some examples to see how things work out in action. And these examples are from my own personal experience, because those are the examples I know best, right? So there we are. What is nanotech? Anything, well, that's less than 100 nanometers, and you work with it, you use it, design it, well, that's called nanotechnology. And nanoscience is to understand the new properties that happen on small scales, right? So now what happens is this. We think about properties as belonging to a material, but actually properties change with size. So if you look at the color of gold, there is no fixed color of gold. It depends on the size of the particle. So if we make a gold particle 10 nanometer across, we make another gold particle 1 nanometer across, they are going to look different. They are going to behave different, right? So idea is, if we make small things, they got special properties that we could exploit, just based on size. And so that's the promise of nanotechnology, that properties don't belong only to a material, but they also functions of size. By changing size, same material could be made insulator or could be made to behave like a metal or a semiconductor or what have you. So you look at the whole suite of properties, like electronic properties, magnetic properties, optical properties, chemical properties, mechanical, everything. Everything depends on the size. So that's the critical message. And of course, the impact of nanotechnology is very wide. So there is nothing while here that you see or anywhere else in life which does not have the promise to get transformed by use of nanotechnology. And a whole lot of it is happening now, and a whole lot would continue to happen. This is not something that I see dying down in the foreseeable future. If anything, we are going to add more and more of nanotechnology in the years and decades to come. So while this run down on different things that happen in nanotechnology, almost everything that you can think of. This could be a new product, this could be a new process, it could be a new way of doing things, could be a new material, could be a new device, everything, right? So it's really very pervasive. Now, while question is, nanotechnology in some form has always been there. And these are classical examples of, you know, nanoparticles embedded in materials that give you, well, vibrant colors, give you different kind of decorative finishes, right? So they have been around for many centuries. What is new about new nanotechnology is that we understand it much better. If we understand it much better, we can control it much better. We can see things that are small, we can manipulate things that are small, right, which was not there, you know, all these centuries ago. So people used nanoparticles as a recipe for doing things. They didn't understand how you would tailor certain kind of property, how can you control things, what many different useful things could be made out of it, right? So all that understanding was not there. So what is new about nanotechnology now is that there is a new technology that would let us handle things on small scales. We could manipulate and control them. What I want to emphasize is we think of nanotechnology as something high-tech, but it's not really only that. It's like there in everyday life, it's there in fast-moving consumer goods, even though we don't, may not recognize it as such. The same brand name 20 years ago may have had a different formulation than we have now, so there could be some nano additions to that formulation. So I'll just give you quickly a few examples where, you know, these are everyday products, but they contain some element of nano in them. So if you go up there, wrinkle-free, stain-resistant clothing, while this may be a composite that's made up of nanofibers of cotton with polyester, or nanofibers of polyester with cotton, to give you a dual functionality. So it behaves like cotton, it feels like cotton, but it's got the durability and stain resistance of polyester, for example. A very big beneficiary of nanotechnology are cosmetic companies and pharmaceuticals. For example, if you think about how do you deliver benefits under the skin, right? The only way to do that, to penetrate the squamous cells of the epithelial skin, would be to have very small particles that would carry some vitamins or some stuff like that and would go through the small pores of the skin and deliver the cargo right underneath it, right? So, it turns out that L'Oreal, for example, yeah, they got about the maximum number of nanotechnology patents, right? So it's maybe not some other electronic company, right? But the companies which are in fast-moving consumer goods, right? So it impacts everyday life in a profound way. Another example is sunscreen. When I first started going to beaches, the sunscreen looked like a milky solution. It was not very attractive to a consumer. But today, while you replace microparticles by nanoparticles, that does two things. It absorbs UV much better. It's got much higher surface area. And it also makes the cream look clear. You know, it's not milky anymore. So well, it's got psychological advantage in terms of packaging and marketing, right? And this has to do with the fact that if you got very small particles, they don't scatter light, right? Because they are smaller than the wavelength of light. So the light just passes through. And then, well, it looks clear, right? High-tech, the tennis rackets and balls. The story about balls is very interesting. So these tennis balls, you know, if you were playing them two decades ago, even a decade ago, they lose air at much faster rate. But now they got a nano coating of nano clay inside the balls that would help retain the shape and the air much longer. Right, so these are just some randomly picked four examples. But the list of this kind is really very huge, very, very long, and it just keeps adding up more and more. So what I want to convey, the message, is not just electronics. Of course, that's the obvious thing where nanotechnology plays a big role, but it's going to play a big role, bigger and bigger role in everything that we do every day. Coming to the next issue about biomimetics, right? So biomimetics is learning from nature, knowing the fundamentals and mechanisms of things like how does things manufacture in nature? What kind of materials does it use? What kind of mechanisms does it use? Right? If we can learn all of that and translate in products, in processes, in technology, that's great. Here are some examples, you know, just again four examples. We look at the vibrant color of butterflies and peacocks. Right? This has to do with nanotechnology. It has to do with the fact that they got a micro and nano texture on the surface. So it's a trick with light if you look at optical physics. So you can show it has nothing to do with pigments or paints, the way you know human man-made technology works. It has to do with micro and nano projections on the surface that give you these vibrant colors. Another very popular example is this lotus effect, right? Now you think about the drop of water, which is sitting on micro and nano projections. So it's not really seeing the surface, it's just floating on a blanket of air. And that's what makes the surface water repellent, right? So it can, of course, while there are a whole lot of technologies now that can reproduce the lotus effect. Think about manufacturing. How do we manufacture things? You see, in nature, we make beautiful ceramics, but it's all done at room temperature, at atmospheric pressure. All the man-made technology for making ceramics is an extreme process, right? So you need very high temperatures, you fire things up, and then, well, don't even make as beautiful things, right? So clearly, there is things that we can learn about manufacturing and fabrication from nature. And a whole lot of things that happen in nature is by self-assembly or self-organization. Nobody is really saying, well, how the tree is going to turn up, right? All that stuff. So think about the fact, well, if we could translate some of these principles in terms of manufacturing, well, that would free up a lot of time for us to pursue other things, right? So here's another example, which is adhesion in nature. I'll talk a little bit more about that. It's been a big enigma. You know, how do these frogs and geckos, they stick onto the surfaces and still walk very fast? On demand, we have no man-made adhesive that can have this dual role and is non-fouling. When I put a tape and then you know peel it out, there's always a stain that's left on the surface and the tape becomes non-reusable. You can't use it again, right? But everything that happens in nature, it has strong adhesion, it can move, it's reusable for the rest of your life, lifetime warranty on that. But there is no glue, right? There is no physical glue. So it is very important. So again, we want to translate some of these ideas from nature into technology. Of course, when you think about ideas from nature, there is such a thing as, well, you know, for example, Icarus syndrome. What that means is a Greek god. He looked at the nature, then he put in two wings, stuck them up with wax, and then started flying towards the sun. The wax melted, Icarus crashed, perhaps died. I don't know if Greek gods died or lived happily ever after. But whatever, it was a disaster. What it basically means is you can't copy blindly. You know, sometimes you can't copy a single element of a very complex system, right? So one has to understand the full mechanism of how things work and then, you know, try to translate that. There's such a thing as translational research now. So, you know, you do a lot of fundamental work, but then you look at the translational aspects of that research, very important. Next question you can ask is, well, we always say that nature evolved, right? So there's evolution, it produces optimal things. What I think is, well, nature doesn't in fact produce optimal things at all. It produces all the variety of things, right? So to do the same thing, it's got n different mechanisms for the same objective. And there, I think, is a very simple reason for it, and there are profound implications of that about how we do work. So nature, first of all, produces diversity. It doesn't concentrate too much on optimizing everything, right? The reason is, well, if you had a community of optimized things, right, which are optimized for a particular set of circumstances. Then when the circumstances change, the whole community collapses at the same time because it cannot meet the threat, right, because it's optimized for certain things, right? But things change all the time, and so it's good to have diversity in order to meet the challenges. And nature has been doing an excellent job of actually meeting those challenges under variable circumstances. So coming to the third aspect of talk, and we try to actually tie in all these different aspects a little bit later, is about, I said, common sense, scientific common sense, if I may, and how creativity, they are related to each other. To me, both of them really mean the same thing, okay? I mean, or some aspects of them, they mean the same thing. It's all about finding connections. Connections between things that look unrelated. Okay, it's just that while here is, you know, is a domain which is considered different and another domain, and nobody really looked at what is the relation between the two domains, right? So if we could integrate, then we have a holistic way of looking at things, and that's, to me, it means, well, scientific common sense, and it's lateral and out-of-box kind of thinking is another way to say the same thing. Of course, a lot of research, I always look at research, there are two different ways of doing research. One of them is problem-centric, the other is what I would call a toolbox-centric approach. What that means is that I know certain tools of the trade, right? Maybe it's called singular perturbation or catastrophe theory or what have you, or some part of quantum mechanics. I go about looking for problems where my tool will fit, right? So I try to invent problems that would fit my tool. Another way to do it would be, here is an important problem. So I am going to invent the tools, they are going to meet the challenge of that particular problem, right? Of course, both ways of doing research are perfectly fine. My personal preference has been shifting when I was young from toolbox-centric approach to a problem-based approach, right? Because, you know, tools have to keep changing to match the challenges, right? So this is a very general kind of issue. Now, in order to do lateral thinking, out-of-box, common sense, creativity, it requires that we think interdisciplinary way. Now, this is a much abused word. I mean, it's like garibi hatao, you know. They say, let's go interdisciplinary, let's do that. It's much easier said than done. It's much easier to do multidisciplinary research than to do interdisciplinary research. The difference is, while multidisciplinary, I got my discipline, you got yours, we will both use our tools and then go home after the problem is solved. In interdisciplinary, we create a new domain, we come out of the boundaries, we meet halfway in no man's land, if you would. We start a new area where it didn't exist earlier by using the expertise of both the areas and then evolving it to a new level. Of course, Buddha anticipated this nearly 15 centuries ago. Say, while there are no distinctions between here and there, people invent them and then believe them to be true, right? It's the believing which is very dangerous for the cause of science. Okay, we of course have to invent domains, right? We need to, each one of us can have a domain knowledge, but not really everything. But then thing is, while it becomes counterproductive to learning, right? We say, I'm a chemical engineer, got nothing to do with physics or mathematics or IT or what have you. When the fact of the matter is that really the process of problem solving is very common, regardless of what the discipline is. So creativity, I already pointed out, is to do with connections between unrelated things, finding new connections. The hallmarks of scientific common sense are simplicity, unexpectedness, and impact that it has. So creativity is not same as intelligence. Of course, we know that. We crack JEE or something like that, while that's considered intelligent, but I'm not sure that it really is very creative pursuit. Or you need a very creative person to do that, right? So creativity involves explorations into unknown using lateral thinking, whereas intelligence would largely limit itself to what is known and dig much deeper, okay? So you make differences in the decimal point, okay, or incremental changes, right? So of course, both of them are needed in science or in fact in human activity. All I'm trying to say is that perhaps we have not emphasized enough the creative part of doing things. And of course, in all the school education, college, that we always emphasize the intelligence and the vertical digging deeper into a particular issue or domain. So just to say, well, a lot of my papers that we write, you know, they look like this, 20 pages of this, right? But I have to keep reminding the students that, you see, you have to think physical. What goes in before the equations start is what comes out in the end. There is no new addition that's going to happen by symbol manipulation. Symbol manipulation is a very powerful tool, of course. We've all been doing it for ages. But you know, you not get new insights. I can pretty much predict what's going to come out from these 20 pages if I knew what goes in, right? And this is actually an art. This is an, you know, intuitive way of thinking about things, about where it's going to lead us, right? You can't really, you know, trust all the numbers that come out blindly. So thinking about common sense and creativity, it means different things to different people. So of course, a very big person says, well, there's prejudices acquired by age 18. Buddha has a different way to look at common sense. He says, well, common sense is in some ways part of our deep knowledge, right? Don't believe him unless it tallies with your common sense and your experiences, right? And of course, I certainly agree with the third statement, right? It's much better to have not very deep education or domain knowledge, but it's much better to have common sense if you were to choose between the two. And again, I emphasize that this part is not well respected in our educational system, because there are no points and test it in the exams. You know, that's a big problem. And one has to think about some ways of addressing that very fundamental, very serious problem. And I can tell you this from my experience. I teach, you know, these very bright students year after year, been doing that for 21 years now. And while there is no common sense, or very little of it, there are hilarious examples. And I can tell you that later, after the lecture, if you know we meet and you want to know more about it. You would just not believe the lack of common sense in very intelligent people that we encounter today. Anyway, so I'm going to come to this point about how to use lateral thinking and creativity and scientific common sense for solving some difficult scientific problems. So I would emphasize not really the very deep scientific elements, but what is creative in that particular problem. Of course, I'm very thankful to all these people, collaborators and students who did some of the work that I'm going to talk about today. What could you do without collaborators and students? Not really very much. Okay, so here, see, we think about different departments of science and technology. You know, here is civil engineering, here is IT, that, blah, blah, right? My way of thinking is there are really only three M's. There is mechanics, there is materials, and there is manufacturing. And really, you can put everybody, there may be two people, one from civil, one from chemical, mechanical. If they all belong to mechanics, they have much more in common with each other than if you put them under different departments, right? So really, there are three different things that happen. Okay, and I'm sure that this, even IT fits in somewhere there. So there is the mechanics of IT, there are materials of IT. Of course, there's some related manufacturing aspects. So I'll talk about two things, two kind of examples. The first one is fabrication on small scales. Now, it's a classical problem. It's a classical problem about how do we make small things, which is a domain of nanotechnology. How do we make small things? So there are a suite of techniques, very well known. They're called top-down techniques from silicon manufacturing, right? So those techniques. But the question is that, well, that we have to think of new techniques for making things on small scales, perhaps the same way as nature does it, right? So I'll come to that in a minute. This one is, it's about what are the different ways you can make something. Right, so you can do one course in manufacturing science, or one can look at this one slide, which basically summarizes how do you make something small. There are three different ways, conceptually, that one can make it. The top down, all the techniques that we know from the realm of silicon technology, like photolithography, electron beams, focused ion beam, all stuff like that goes into making chips. This is called top down techniques, which means remove some material, add some material. Okay, it's basically that. Use a drill to remove material, deposit something, and shape the stuff. Bottom-up techniques are basically take small things and make something larger with it, for example, this room, right? And when this happens, the assembly happens by itself, is called self-assembly, and that is how nature does it. There is a third way of making something, which is called self-organization, and my group basically concentrates on self-organization. It has to do with the fact that you make something simple, which is easy to make, and then transform that shape into something more complex and something more useful. Right? Now that happens spontaneously. It happens spontaneously because that simple thing that you made is unstable, so it wants to change. And it wants to change spontaneously. If we know that process of change, we can control it. Right? So that's the basic idea about self-organization. Incidentally, I meet many even very senior experienced scientists who refer to bottom-up as bottoms-up, which is an entirely different thing. Right? This is while taking a glass of whatever and just gulping it down, right, in one shot. So not make that mistake, no, bottom-up, completely different from that. Now, so coming to this lotus effect, right, it's like, you know, when you take a tawa, which is very hot, and throw in some water drops. They never touch tawa, they float on a blanket of vapor. Similarly, lotus leaves, if you look at magnified image of lotus leaves, they got these micro needles and projections coming out on which water sits like a drop of mercury. So it rolls off very easily and it cannot be wetted by water. So this is why one of my good friends from France, he thought of the name Fakir drops. And to bring in the analogy, the Fakir is sitting on a bed of nails, and similarly water drops are sitting on micro nails, right, very comfortably and not really being touched by it. So this is the power of nano-textured surfaces. Essentially what I want to convey is that if you change the texture of a surface, it changes, these properties change. Now, what we mean by properties, it's optical properties, it's color, for example. The friction on the surface changes. The wetting properties change. So a whole lot of different things or adhesive properties change. All that can be done by a simple trick of nanotechnology is by putting in nanotexture on the surface. So of course, we also need nanotexture for making devices in polymers, whole lot of devices, microfluidic devices, electronic devices, displays, lab on a chip devices, what have you. All of this requires nanofabrication, right? Using soft materials like liquids, polymers, stuff like that, not metals, but soft materials. There is something special about soft materials because nature always works with soft materials. The reason it works with soft materials is because it's very easy to self-assemble them with the small forces. It's very easy to self-organize them. A metal, you know, you really have to hit it with a hammer before anything happens to it, right? But these soft biological material stuff like that, easy to work with them. So here I want to basically tell you the philosophy of self-organization. Again, to repeat, if we have something very small, it's usually unstable. It wants to change. There are profound reasons why small things are unstable. They got very high surface to volume ratio. And surfaces have a lot of energy, a lot of pent-up energy that they want to release very quickly. So things want to change. Now, if we can control that change, then we can use it as a tool of manufacturing and fabrication. Second thing that I want to talk about is, can we use a field as a tool of fabrication? What I mean by that is not a mechanical, physical tool. We think about fabrication by using a drill, punching a hole, right? That's a, like things come in contact. But think about it, actually if you have a programmable field that will create flow and deformation in a material, then you can use that as a tool of manufacturing. Contactless and very fast tool, which is very convenient, programmable tool, right? So that's the whole point that same tool for different purposes. For different manufacturing, you can program the tool, which is almost like science fiction, but it's very quickly becoming a reality. So here is an example of using this kind of tool. In fact, in this example, we could organize polymer on different length scale, you know, create these very nice texture on the surface, but without using a tool. So without using a conventional tool of fabrication, but by self-organizing the polymer. And this self-organization occurs because of the, well, I don't know if I should take this name, Van der Waals forces. Okay, so Van der Waals forces, they are everywhere. Idea is to understand them and to control them, to direct them for the self-assembly. And this is a beautiful example of changing the topography of a surface by just understanding, by harnessing that particular Van der Waals force. And of course that one can think about, well, the self-organization, we can also deliver some functional material through the self-organization. In this particular case, we have a cargo to deliver at some predetermined places. So all of these little dots of polymer, they contain some gold nanoparticles. And this is required for a large number of technologies that I don't have time to go into. Idea is, how do we localize functional material at predetermined sites? And this can be done by conventional technology, but at huge cost and effort, which means basically, well, how are you going to pick up small things and start placing them where you want them, right? It's a very daunting task. But self-organization does it for you. In a sense that first, of course, you have to understand the self-organization and direct it and control it, then it will do for you what you want get done, right? So you got really millions of these tiny slaves working for you for free, really. Here is a power of self-organization. So using that, we could make for the first time the nano lenses. So look at these little tiny lenses which just come out of self-organization. It's a little bit, well, scientifically, it's a little bit long story, so I don't get into that. But I want to show the power of self-organization. If you wanted to make these nano lenses by conventional technology, each of these lenses might cost upwards of $2,000 and would take many months to make. And the profile of the lens would not be so clean, because any kind of machining would make rough surfaces, but not a very smooth surface. Now, of course, the question is, what can you do with nano lenses? Why do you want to make them? And of course, we can also make an array of nano lenses. So you see that there is an array of nano lenses, two-dimensional array. These kind of arrays are very useful in a whole lot of technologies, varying from imaging at high magnification. So over here, you see a picture that put a nano lens, and you can see the stuff underneath it. This is called beyond the diffraction limit imaging, or near field imaging, right? So typically things which are of the order of half the wavelength of light cannot be imaged using a microscope. So here you see that things are not visible, but wherever you put a nano lens, things become, they light up, right? So it's a very low cost but huge magnification microscope. And in fact, this can be assembled in a high school lab. Okay, it doesn't require high technology actually to make it, because self-organization is an empowering tool. It takes you beyond the limit of existing technology, which may be very expensive, right? So if you look at typical nanofab facility, okay, if it's a manufacturing facility, it would run into billions of dollars, but even a modest university nanofab facility runs into order of $50 million, right? But here, and all of those facilities, in fact, could not make nano lenses, right? But here you can actually make it for $10 in a high school lab by exploiting the power of self-organization. One can do high resolution imaging. In fact, we can use it, these nano lenses, in many creative ways. What we are doing now is you pick them, these nano lenses, by light, which is called optical tweezers. You can lend them where you want to do imaging. So imaging on site, on demand. For example, you can lend them on the membrane of a cell, and you can do imaging in situ. You can also puncture the cell by shining a laser through this lens exactly where you want to puncture it and deliver DNA to it, for example. So these manipulations become possible. What else can one do with it? So do a little bit of lateral thinking. Yeah, so point is that we got this array of nano lenses. Now, if you think about what I want to do is miniaturize, make a miniature copy of a complex object in a periodic way, so over a large surface area, which is good for many different technologies, right? So we want, and this is usually done by photolithography. You could do the same thing, okay, because you got this array of lenses, and you shine in an image through them. You would make small copies of that image on a material called photoresist. Then you can develop the photoresist, much like a photographic film. I don't know, many people here looking at the ages may not know photographic film, but it used to be there. Take it from me, before the digital cameras. And basically, the image is basically processed on a sheet of paper, right? And you can do exactly the same thing by this particular idea, right? So sometimes, you know, you're watching a movie, you can think about, well, where does technology come in this? Could I make these small mirrors, small lenses, and one can do a whole lot of fantastic things with it. Now, one of the challenges in the technology area in which I work is related to processing of high-speed coatings. Everything we use is coated, right? So it could be paper, steel, textile, laminates, everything is coated because of functional reasons, corrosion, scratch resistance, and then other functions like friction control, wetting control, colors, stuff like that. So the challenge is that one has to do patterning or generate micro texture on the surface very fast, because a roll-to-roll processing, things move at a speed of 100 meters per second, and to do patterning or to create texture on the surface very fast is a big challenge. And you cannot use the technology like, well, these top-down techniques because they are very expensive. And for consumer products, if you're making an electronic device, it's okay. But for consumer products like this, it would not sell at that particular cost. So here is the use of electric field as a tool of manufacturing. So I pointed out we can use electric field as a tool of manufacturing. This is, well, a translation of that idea. So you have a polymer film, which is a coating, apply electric field perpendicular to it, it generates pattern on the surface right away. Okay. You have to do nothing more than, well, apply 10 volts across, and then, well, this stuff is moving at very fast speed, but you get these patterns, right? And these patterns can be tuned by programming the electric field. So, in fact, one can get far more complex patterns, repetitive patterns over large areas as the web is moving. By basically programming the electric field. So if you think about a pixelated electrode, in each pixel, one can control the voltage, and change it with time. Well, if you do that, one can control the micro and nano structure which is being generated on the surface. So I want to illustrate one aspect of doing scientific research, which is, well, that these things that happen by chance, okay? And most of my students, when something happens by chance, they come back and say, it didn't work. You know, they say, the experiment didn't work. So you have to keep telling them there is no such thing as a failed experiment. Okay, it might have failed because your expectations were different, you were looking in a different place. There is such a thing as a failed theory. There's no such thing as a failed experiment. If you have learned nothing from a failed experiment, then only it has failed. But you could learn so many things from this particular experiment. So I'll give you an example of what we were trying to do when we actually came across something very interesting because the experiment failed. So we wanted to mimic shark's skin. Now shark's skin is anti-fouling, is anti-stick surface. And the reason it is so is because of the micro texture, which is very sharp on its surface, which looks like that. So nothing can really stick with that. So we wanted to make a surface like that. We made it by a conventional micro fabrication technique. So here you see that the surface, the polymer surface here, it looks the same as the shark skin. To stabilize this surface, you have to heat it. It's called annealing. Right, so the student did a bit of annealing, and I said, experiment failed. So what he meant was that all these structures, they split right in the middle. You see, so that the thing is destroyed. Okay, so you see there that all the triangles out there, they split right in the middle to create a nano channel. Now, creating nano channels is far more important than to create shark's skin, because right, he would have thrown away the sample. I say, oh, this is great. This is, you know, an example of self-organization. So you create channels out of nothing. The reason it happens is because there are a lot of stresses at the sharp corners. And when you heat it, they relax, so it splits, right? So you can make these nano channels, billions of them, very inexpensively and in any high school lab. So our emphasis is always on high school lab, as you can see, right? And you can make it. To make the same channels by focused ion beam and stuff like that cost tremendous amount of time and money, right? And of course, what can you do with nano channels? That's, well, we'll discuss it some other day. Okay, there are two other things that I want to illustrate about, you know, general scientific thinking and way of doing things. So, well, we look at, you know, when you want to magnify something and you want to look at it, you say you need to see it, right? So we say seeing is believing. But nobody says, well, what is actually seeing? What are the mechanisms of seeing? Right? One mechanism of seeing is the visual seeing. But of course, how does a blind man see? You know, so you close your eyes, you take a stick, you well, poke everything with it, and then you make a visual map. Right? If you do the same thing with a micro stick, okay, and then translate that in terms of technology, it becomes an atomic force microscope, and it becomes a scanning tunneling microscope, right, which got one of the fastest Nobel Prizes, right? So it's just a question of how do you, you know, make a lateral displacement about thinking, you know? So seeing doesn't necessarily mean that it has to be always visual using an electromagnetic radiation. It could be mechanical, for example. Another recent example is making graphene, which is two-dimensional sheet of carbon atoms, right? It's hugely popular, is very important for the next generation electronics and devices. Idea is, how do you make a two-dimensional sheet of carbon atoms? Now, these people, well, in 2010, they got Nobel Prize. While they take a scotch tape, they put it on a block of graphite, they peel the scotch tape, some part of graphite, it sticks to the scotch tape, and many times it's a single layer of carbon atoms. Okay, so it's as simple as that, right? Now you can say, well, there's no deep quantum mechanics in this, stuff like that, not classical physics, but this is a different way of doing things. But the amazing thing about this story is not that, you know, that you can make graphene by peeling a tape. The amazing part is that people have been doing the same thing for 30 years. In my lab, we have been doing this for 11 years, right? We were doing it to create a fresh surface of graphite block, right? So you create, by peeling the tape, you create a fresh, a new surface of graphite, you throw away the tape. Okay, graphite is important, right? But these people, they threw away the graphite and they kept the peeling tape, okay? So there is no difference between exactly what was being done for a long time. It's a question of where do you focus, okay? It's very important we discard things which are more important sometimes, and we kind of focus on conventional things, right? And we keep repeating it for 30 years. It's unbelievable, right? So here is an example of this gecko adhesion in nature. This is another example of where you focus is very important, right? So I already introduced the problem. There is no glue, right? Things stick very well. They move around very fast, right? And there is no physical glue, and there is no man-made glue that would behave like that, right? So big technology challenge. So there is, of course, intense research related to this particular problem. And basically, when you think of adhesion, you think of this as a surface property. You think adhesion is only on the surface. If I modify the surface, it will modify stickiness, right? But we had a different way to think about it. It's a very old problem, right? Search for a reusable, non-contaminating, high-strength, self-cleaning, soft-dry adhesive, also works in water, is a holy grail of adhesion. Right? It has been around. Even Aristotle was very intrigued by this particular problem. He said, how does that happen, right? Anyway, so the question we were asking was a little bit different than what others were asking. Because others were said, adhesion is only on the surface. We said, well, maybe it is, but maybe what happens inside also matters, right? So you ask, you know, your focus shifts a little bit, and then that can lead to something new. In this particular case, it did. So what we did is you take a material which is non-sticky. It does not stick, like, you know, a layer of rubber or something like that. Now we drill holes inside that layer of rubber and fill them with some liquid. Lo and behold, the adhesion, it increases by two orders of magnitude. We did not change the material. We did nothing on the surface. Same material, same surface. Punch holes inside, fill it with liquid, and it increases adhesive power by two orders of magnitude. And it also becomes a reversible adhesive because the surface is, you know, is like my skin. Okay, it doesn't stick. Okay, there is no glue on the skin, right? So it is a reversible adhesive. You can peel it, you can stick it again, peel it, stick it again. It's very interesting about, well, what is the physics behind it, right? So I don't have time to get into physical aspects, but basically it works because, I just give you a little clue. It's a science lecture. I must say something about science or it would be completely fake, right? So let me do my two bit about this. So you see, a very important thing is, it's much easier to propagate a crack than to initiate one. When I want to start a crack, I have to hit it really hard. But once the crack forms, it can go without consuming any energy. So what happens is when you got these pockets inside, they stop the crack. They stop the propagation of crack. Right? It stops, it dissipates all the energy, and then you have to restart it. Right? So that takes a lot more energy. Right? So the adhesion becomes much stronger. And then, of course, well, there were lots of popular press related to this particular work. And one person who is a biologist, he was of the opinion that maybe tree frogs have the similar mechanism. Now, I couldn't vouch for it because I don't know the anatomy of, you know, tree frogs. But there could be some biomimetic connections related to this particular example. Maybe the last example, you see, if you want to make something small, now you can do it by top-down, bottom-up, self-organization, but then I was watching this movie, a popular movie of the 80s, right? So we know, Honey, I Shrank the Kids. They say, look, you can make something small by making something big and by shrinking it, isn't it? So it seems very simple as a concept. Now, I mean, once a concept is there, it's not very difficult to translate that technologically into a working principle, right? So in this particular case, very simple, you take a three-dimensional object which is a little bit big, 10 micron, right? Then do molding with a gel, then dry the gel, so gel shrinks, right? And then you do molding again, do it four times, and you would shrink the size by one order of magnitude. Now the reason it's important is because you know, the cost of fabrication goes up exponentially as you decrease size. It's much easier to make a 10 micron object than to make 1 micron object, and then to make a 100 nanometer object, right? So here are some examples of starting big and shrinking it in size. And this can be done in a high school lab. So I need not keep repeating that. Everything we do can be done in a high school lab, which is not to say we don't have the tools to do something more difficult, but those are things that we publish in papers, right? So here I talk about things which are high school stuff, right? Now, the final examples is working with a new material which is inspired by nature. So you see, when we make devices, it could be devices like micro-electromechanical systems or sensors or electronic devices, we think of two materials, silicon or polymers or plastics. But we thought about the fact, well, why not make devices in carbon? Carbon is a preferred material, and there are many reasons for it. It's the most versatile single material available to the man. You can functionalize it in different ways, change porosity, change its properties very easily. It's a conducting material, is available in many, many different forms, from diamond, graphene, graphite, carbon nanotubes, amorphous carbon. So it's very versatile. You can get a whole lot of properties in carbon you could not get in any other material. So therefore, one has to think about, can I make things in carbon? Why should I stick to silicon? There are certain things I can make in carbon that would work much better, right? But the question is, how do I fabricate in carbon? I can't use the same technology that is used for silicon manufacturing. So new material means new technology. Now, if I gave this problem to an intelligent undergraduate, how do I fabricate in carbon? I ask him. He will say, I'll use photolithography, sir. Usually they say sir also, right? I'll use photolithography. I'll tell them, don't call me sir. Then they'll say, yes, sir, right? Okay, so he'll say, I will use the same tools I got. Okay, I'll make it in carbon. But you see, a lateral solution to this problem is, first you fabricate the same structure in a polymer and then carbonize the polymer. So carbonization is a process by which you remove all the organic material and leave carbon behind. Any device you can fabricate in a polymer can be converted into the same device in carbon, okay, by this technique. Right, so one doesn't have to worry about, well, for carbon, other techniques are not well suited, how do I make it, right? So the general idea is, you make something in which, you make anything in a material in which it is easy to make, and then convert it into the final product. Okay, it's not always necessary to do fabrication in the final material of choice. So here are some examples of making devices in carbon. One final message, perhaps. You see that there are two kind of things that scientists make. One is very structured, which are made mostly by physicists. Then there are very disordered materials called nanomaterials, made mostly by chemists. However, you see, most of the important things actually lie in the middle, which is called a fractal. These are multi-scale structures. Nature works through multi-scale structures. The reason is multi-scale means multifunctional, right? So each scale has a different functionality. And you can also show, of course, that this is the most efficient pathway of distributing material, energy, whatever you got, like lungs pathway, or this, you know, distribution of nutrients in a tree, right? So it looks like a tree. Only problem is we don't know how to make micro or nano trees using conventional techniques. So therefore, well, one has to have a little bit of chemistry, a little bit of physics, materials, manufacturing, put them all together to make a tree-like structure on small scales, which can immediately be used in things like micro batteries, for example. Don't have time to talk about it in detail, but here are the examples. So you make the leaf or the flower of the tree by playing around with chemistry. Okay, this is a carbon flower, a micron size. And then while you make these stem, the big trunk of the tree by physical techniques. So these are all micro trunks. Then you get them, these two guys together to make something over there. Okay, which is much better to use than simply either a flower or the trunk. So you have to combine the two. So there we go. Another challenge which was solved intuitively for carbon MEMS or carbon devices was you got these micro posts. How do you wire them up? That's a big challenge in actually all the micro and nanotechnologies. So how do you take a nano wire and then, well, put it on two posts or two electrodes? Right, one, the conventional way to do that would be, well, use a nano manipulator, may cost $1 million. Then, well, take 2 hours to pick up a single wire, position it very meticulously. But that's not going to work for manufacturing. Clearly, it would work for research, but it's not going to work for mass production. So here we do it by self-assembly. Now, this works because all the posts, you know, you apply an electric field on these posts, so they work like micro lightning rods. They attract these nanofibers, right? And then they just zip all the nano posts on their own. You don't have to do anything. Just create the right kind of conditions for these guys to recognize each other because of high field strength, and they can create a network of these nanowires which are basically joining up all the posts. You can even use them as sensors by looking at the current voltage characteristics. So I would nearly stop there. Now, when I agreed to give this lecture, Bhavna here told me that I could talk about the problems that Indian scientists face or how does one overcome them. That seemed like a little bit of a triviality to have the whole lecture devoted to it. So I made one slide, okay, about, well, what a scientist has to do in this country or any other country, or in fact, even a non-scientist has to do a good job of life, is to have two things. You know, so Schopenhauer, he wrote 4 books about the world as an idea and as will, right? So one needs will, which is the same as passion or intensity, right? And one needs a good idea. Now, of course, the thing about idea, that's much more important for a developing economy like India as maybe elsewhere. The reason is you may not have all the tools right today. You may not have a lab which is worth $50 million. We cannot wait forever to do good things until we would get a lab which is worth $50 million. So many things can be driven by a good idea, right? So that's what we have to keep telling students, that I kept telling myself. When I joined IIT Kanpur 21 years ago, the infrastructure just wasn't there. Okay, you couldn't do anything. So you had to be driven by will and by ideas. Right, and this is, I would still suggest to everybody who is aspiring to do passionate scientific work to pay attention to these two things. Don't give up. Things would not work, of course, that's good, right? And then just be at it, and then, well, something nice would come out of it. The only other thing I would like to say, you know, young scientist, it is good to have at least one more abiding interest outside of your lab interest, you know. So it's something that one is deeply committed to, because it really reinforces what one does in the lab. Okay, so one doesn't become like a zombie after leaving the lab. My passion has been drawing sketches, you know, or making paintings like that, which I often do if I'm sitting in a conference or a meeting. Now, it so happens that by doing this, you really, I can really tell you, you can concentrate better on the speaker. I don't know how it happens, okay, it's because if you are too bored, right, one can't concentrate. Okay, but by doing this, you know, by doing your passionate hobby, you know, you are not bored, right? There's something happening, right? And then you are able to concentrate much better, be much more efficient. And the other, of course, things that young people ask is, well, what the future holds, stuff like that. There is a simple answer to that. There is no future but the one that you make, right? Thank you very much. Yes, the Prigozhin, he really bring to fore the importance of self-organization, made it a more popular topic, right? And he was both because, you know, so as a scientist, sometimes he was criticized for making it too popular, right? He said a little bit of, you know, like pandering to popular, whatever, playing up to the gallery. But anyway, he did a good service by putting in certain principles of, for example, irreversible thermodynamics, to bring in, well, how do we apply it to self-organizational processes. By the same time, you know, some part of his group that carried on the task, the mission, they kind of got a little bit carried away. Okay, so they said, yeah, everything, you know, this is great, everything, right? But there's such a thing as overdoing something, right? So many things have happened beyond Prigozhin, and a lot of it is driven by the advent of nanotechnology. Because it's really important in nanotechnology because you can see things, you can manipulate things, right? So let them happen by their own, you know, if you can do that, then there is no good, better substitute for it. Right? Small things, if they can self-assemble, if they can self-organize, is a very powerful technique. So one way to look at the problem of adhesion is to change the material, which is the conventional way of looking at adhesion. The way we were looking at it is independent of material. So you can pose a question like this. Let me take a non-sticky material like my skin and turn it into a Spider-Man's skin, right? So take this skin, don't down with the chemical composition of the skin, okay? But turn it into a sticky surface. The reverse question is equally interesting, which is take a sticky surface and turn it into a non-stick surface, right? And both of them have both lot of interesting fundamental science as well as technological implications. We believe the central dogma of biology. We all born with whoever we are, right? Which is all in the DNA or what have you, you know, coding for proteins, the kind of proteins you make, right? That's who you are. They say, so the biologists, the way of thinking would be, you are your proteins, right? Hopefully not, but anyways, it could be one way to look at it. So how you make connections? Well, I think you make connections because if you have interest in many different things other than your formal studies or stuff like that. I mean, if you have real interest, let's say in your friends, in people, in books, in roaming around, things like that, you make natural connections. So I don't know if you can really teach it in a class because people are too focused on the exam, you see. So it's not, they will always ask, what is in it for me, right? Because they're only thinking about exam, they're not thinking about life in its totality. new technology, concurrent ethical concerns. There are health issues related to it. There are many different things, and there is indeed a very intense activity, research activity surrounding these issues. So, one way to put it would be, of course, we always had nanoparticles. You know, so if you look at car exhaust, it's got trillions of nanoparticles. Right. The thing is, earlier we did not know about them. So there was no question about, well, what is a health risk? So when you become more aware of actually things, then you start probing deeper into the question of, well, what are the health implications? What is the ethical implications? Stuff like that. But it's not greatly different from any other new technology. It is different in quantity, because nanotechnology is not a single technology, right? Because there is nanotechnology in fabrics. You can say, well, what are the health and ethical concerns related to fabrics, right? And similarly for every other branch of technology where nanoparticles would go in, for example, right? So certainly, it's a very alive area of research, right? Of course, there never be a rollback of any technology either because of ethical or, health concerns, unless they are very grave. You know, because every technology carries certain amount of risk, right? Every time I step out on Kanpur roads, I know what my risks are, very huge, right? But one thing is, you can't live without that technology, right? You have to go from point A to point B, fly, drive, whatever. It all involves risk. At the moment, I don't know that there is any some nanotechnology risk of very grave magnitude. Okay, no such thing exists. There may be, smaller risk, but they are related to different domains, and there is work going on related to those and how to contain those. It's just that, well, people do something, they find something, and then they make a logical case for it. Okay, they say, oh, I always knew it, I'm so intelligent, I'm so smart, I knew from the beginning I'm going to get that, right? So I think that, and when you want to publish it or you want to patent it, you of course have to present it in a linear, logical sequence. But doing real work is non-linear. You don't really start with point A and then you charted out all the domains B, C, D to Z, right? You jump from point to point, you retrace your steps, do corrections, and sometimes, you get lucky, right? I think it's just a whole lot of people get lucky, okay? But of course, they get lucky because they are looking for it. One has to be prepared to be lucky also in some ways, right? As they say, luck favors those, blah, blah. So one, but people get lucky more often than they report. This is my suspicion. Yeah. Yeah, everything in nature, half of it happens by self-organization. In fact, at different scales. So it is not only one particular scale. That it happens all the way from cellular or subcellular level to the level of the biggest 100-year-old tree, right? So there is organization on different scales as well as coming together of things on different scales, and it happens. There are two aspects of this question, and this gets a little bit scientific, right? So self-organization happens because everything wants to minimize its energy, right? So it's like going into a well, like a ball going down the well to minimize its energy, right? Now, on the other hand, there are disturbances in the environment or, even thermal fluctuations that try to drive it away from the well. Right, so if this well of energy is not very deep, you could knock the ball out and it would become random. So see, everything like entropy, it wants to randomize everything, chaos. It wants to increase the disorder, right? But these weak forces or other things, they want to minimize the energy. So there's always a competition between these two things, right? So you want to dig a deep enough well so that things will go and get stuck there, and the disorder will not come back again. So that's one aspect. The second part is all about controls. So you see, in a sense, self-organization is a misnomer. I mean, it is, you know, it's invented by those people who value self very highly. Okay, there's a self all the time, me, mine, I, right? Actually, there is, in a pure form, there is no self-organization. It's always directed. Okay, so now it's directed because we design it. Okay, the design principle in nature is through DNA coding, right? Now, if you want, and in lab, we design it because we first have to understand the mind of the system. We create the right kind of conditions for that self-organization to happen. These right kind of conditions could mean temperature, pressure, composition, material, whatever. Only after I create all those conditions that have to be controlled by non-self, okay, that you would have self-organization. That was the whole idea in a holistic education. However, now we have broken down education by these different watertight compartments. No, and then there is no relation even within one compartment. You see, the knowledge is divided into chapters, right? And these many chapters would come in the first exam, these many in the second, and so forth. And there is no integration. There is no backward or forward integration of what one knows. Thermodynamics is different from fluid mechanics, so on, right? Everything is different. And once you have done that course, one cannot relate it neither to any other course, nor in fact to your life itself, right? So, which is in fact very strange. It's strange, and I think that's one of the reasons that people lose the joy of education, right? Yeah, I mean, if one remembers it all the time to observe, you know, not be too self-centered all the time. And this self includes, you know, our training, right? It's the conditioning that we have received for many decades, right? So if you can kind of forget it now and then one can observe much better. And through that observation and then recalling your experiences and maybe knowledge of different things, or even just doing common, a lot of things are solved by common sense. I really do not think that, you know, one needs very great domain knowledge to solve many of the problems. Of course, once you have a conceptual solution to the problem, then you need domain knowledge to kind of to sharpen the solution, right? To implement it, to translate it in terms of a real technology. That needs domain knowledge, right? But a conceptual solution often does not need domain knowledge. In fact, domain knowledge may be quite quite the stumbling block, because one doesn't see beyond it. You know, he says one cannot explore the surroundings if one is highly confined into a well, right? So sometimes one has to forget the domain knowledge, have interest in other things, and just see connections. Always think about, well, I've been concentrating on this aspect of the problem, but there must be some other aspect. So if you keep reminding yourself about this idea, right, then perhaps it's easier to do lateral thinking.